Here. Mrs. Erickson?
Here.
Mr. Gabbiani is not quite here, he's not away. Mr. Hamlin?
Here.
Mr. Madison?
Here.
Mr. Paulson?
Here.
Mr. Brown?
Here. Mr. Hamlin, would you please leave us in the back of the room?
To the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
We have our communication with the whole school and Mr. Baker here.
Good evening, everyone, and welcome to Wheaton High School. But I need you to turn on. Yes. Maybe 1 second, yes.
6 seconds.
Tonight is a special night for us in the fact that we have two different groups of people that we would like to showcase for our Board of Education and our community. The first is a group of young people who have demonstrated remarkable leadership and have begun to kind of reshape the culture of our school in many ways. As some of you know, I have four different student advisory groups. I have a freshman sophomore advisory group and a junior senior advisory group. Those two groups are selected by our counselors. I also have a multicultural advisory group that originates through our English as a Second Language program, but then kind of grows out of that to address the diversity of our school and to celebrate the diversity of our school. The group I'm going to introduce you to tonight is from our African American advisory group. This is a group of young people who took it upon themselves to make sure that our school understands the significant role that African Americans have played in the contemporary culture of the United States of America. Before 2016, Wheaton Little South, Wheaton Central, Quebec, as far as you know, had never celebrated Black History Month. But 2 years ago, students who were a part of this group, and some of them, they were much younger then, but they were a part of that. And we had our first celebration of Black History Month. This year, what these four young people behind me, who you're about to meet, what they did went way above and beyond what we had in the past. And hopefully, they've set a bar for those who follow them to continue this early, but yet, we're going to call it a tradition because we're South. We talk about tradition a lot. For those who follow in their wake to continue to talk about all of the wonderful things that African Americans have done in the United States. So without further ado, I'll introduce to you our representatives from our African American advisory group. They are all seniors, starting with Ryan Young, Kendall Simpson, Dylan Rodez Washington, and Aziza, help me, Malo, yes, I didn't want to mess it up. So, guys, step on up, please.
So 2 years ago, the recognition of our African American MLD started off with us having concerns on kids saying the N-word in classes, and just we wanted teachers to be more aware of what was happening and for them to call out and not be afraid to tell students of color and students not of color of why they should say the word. So that's how we originated, firstly, with this group. Secondly, was to bring more awareness to Black History Month and the awareness of what African American pioneers have done for our country, which most kids in this school aren't really aware of, and that's what we did to start out this group.
Hello, I'm
Lizzie.
We brought in the advocate group, she organized that. It was very powerful for us, and they gave a lot of respect to other people and showed things that we had never shared with other people that we don't have knowledge about. And then we also got a lot of positive feedback from all the listeners we've
as you said, putting posters and banners and all sorts of decorations on the school, showcasing athletes, entertainers, astronomers, competition, anybody to show, to show off all the African-Americans that have done something great for our culture. Also, we're going to do musical performers to show off artists and also entertainers so that we can share some of our culture. Everybody will understand how to pioneer our musical mission and everything that we have in our culture.
First and foremost, I'd like to thank Mr. Claypool for allowing us to have a group and have a voice. Firstly, what I did first was make the shirts. It was a great sight seeing teachers and all race, everyone of color wearing the shirts and supporting what we made. Secondly, last year we had dreams of doing this and that, and we didn't come to them. In August is when our first meeting usually starts, and Dr. Claypool came in and he told us what he wanted to do, and then we needed to step up. And hearing it from a Caucasian male really brought passion and sacrifice to me and my group members. So we took it upon ourselves to go out and do good things. So first, my grandfather is Billy Williams, a Hall of Fame baseball player, if you know the name. He got him in. He was supposed to come last year, but it was too late. And he made a promise to me that he would come in. So we got him in. We had the MLK project, posters, and doing everything we can to get Black History Month established in the new Mobile South. It started off as a pilot, like you said. It was okay at first, but it didn't go too well. And then we had the second year, didn't go great. But our third year really put us in the door and everything. And with our younger students, we set a goal, and we said that anything is attainable. You just have to go do it with time, effort, and work. So that's what we did with Black History Month. And not only do we do those things, but we're continuing to push for Black History Month, and we're establishing a meeting with Dr. Fisk, the head of the social studies department here, to create a class that includes Black history, which is sort of like a world civic sociology class. So that's what we did for Black History Month. We're very proud of it. I just want to thank the teachers, everything that went through the school.
Here a little bit about all the impressive things that they plan to do and places that they plan to go. So thank you to the Student Excellence Foundation. Thank you to our parents for joining us for the reception. With that, I'm going to invite Mr. Claypool and Mr. Miskin to come up and begin our recognition of our National Merit Scholar, something we're very, very proud of.
Yes, I know the board is very well aware of these. These young people are exceptional beyond whatever the definition may be in a dictionary these days. They demonstrate the best academically in what we have as students at the Little South, but they demonstrate a lot more than just the academic side of what they bring to our school and what they will offer the world once they leave our care. So we have six National Merit finalists from the Little South, so I'll introduce them one at a time. Are you asking them to come forward? So you guys, we'll come through here to make our way through. Maya Shadaraj. Maya. Andrew Dixon.
Are mobilizing to move Foley out of our Pleasant Hill Elementary School. I understand Dr. Raymer is meeting with the election commission to encourage them to move out of our building before the upcoming November 18 election. However, short of state legislation, we cannot ensure that they won't return, even if they do agree to leave currently. So, we are faced with this reality. The best defense is a good offense. Here, you have the chance to create the best offense and create a policy that prevents our children from even being in school while bullying is taking place. With a master's degree in forensic psychology and as a former forensic social worker in New York City, I understand more than most that we cannot completely eliminate the possibility of violence by an individual. However, we can be wise in the access we allow to our students and our staff. We are the only school in our district affected by this. However, our 633 students plus staff are worth our best wisdom and discernment. Mr. Roman, when you were running for election in 2011, you did an interview with a Wheaton patch in which you stated the board, quote, must engage in dialogue with the community to understand the community's expectations for our schools and at the same time exercise financial diligence. Now this quote was specifically addressing the educational excellence, but it also applies here. We can be proactive with the resources we currently have in order to keep our children safe on election day. Currently, Pleasant Hill has hired additional staff to cover the gym during election hours. Obviously, this is a small amount of money, but it takes effort and time to schedule, and it is a cost year after year after year. Pleasant Hill parents will demand an armed presence anytime there is an election at our school. If no police are available, the district will be responsible to hire a private security firm for that day. That is an additional cost. So, here's your opportunity to both engage with us about our expectations and control costs. We are asking that this board diligently review the school calendar and adjust it as needed, I understand working with the union, to make in-service days align with election days. I also understand, as explained by Dr. Schuler, the challenges that this introduces working with both trimesters and semesters within our district. Oak Park is on trimesters and also a polling place that has in-service days aligned with those days. Please reach out to them and use them as a resource about how they designed their school calendar. Ms. Harrison, in your interview with the Daily Herald prior to your election, you stated our talented and devoted teachers are our most important asset in District 200, and I couldn't agree more. It's important that you all understand that our teachers and staff at Pleasant Hill are scared. They are frustrated and they are frightened about having strangers in our school during the bullying hours. The addition of a sheriff's officer for this upcoming election is excellent, and I am thankful we have them, but it is not a long-term solution. Please, join myself and other parents in attacking this problem from multiple angles. Pressure the election commission to get out of our school and adjust our school calendar to address the immediate years, especially knowing that at any time the election commission has the right to move back into our school and we cannot stop them. Please lead the charge in being our best partners. I and other parents will support you.
I'm reading this correctly. The second individual speaker is May Lang. And that, I thought it was an easy one. Matt Lang? I'll come back to him. Next individual speaker would be Summer Fridge.
King.
King? I'm sorry.
No, it's okay. All right. Hi, my name is Summer King. I'm a homeowner, parent of two elementary age children in District 200. I'm here to express my and so many of my friends and neighbors' complete support in the lease arrangement that the board has put forth to fund a new urban learning center. Having followed the process closely as a volunteer on the Citizens Advisory Committee, I can attest to the fact that the board has looked at many, many, many scenarios before considering this one. Personally, I was fully in support of the most recent referendum question, which would have funded the building of a new early learning center, but I know many in our community were not. As somebody who walked door to door and had face-to-face conversations with many members of the community, some of whom did not support the referendum, I can say that most of the people I spoke with simply did not want their taxes raised, but had nothing against the board finding a different way to pay for the early learning center. That is exactly what the board has done. I hope tonight will move us one step further down the path towards an adequate and accessible building for our earliest learners. Thank you.
and I will return back. No problem.
Thank you so much for taking my comments, Ted. I want to speak to you about the issue of polling at Pleasant Hill Elementary School. As an alumni of Pleasant Hill, this is especially personal to me. During the 2008 election, when polling was at Pleasant Hill, and in subsequent elections, it was a great opportunity for me to engage in the civic process and see it in action. And going with that, that has fostered a lasting engagement. I'm currently the acting precinct committeeman for Milton's 116th precinct, and that polls at Pleasant Hill. So this is very important to me, and I just want to make sure that should the board opt to work with the election commission to move the polling place elsewhere, I want to make sure that there's a solid plan in place. There's not a lot of places in our area that can handle being a polling place. We need to be compliant, we need to have materials and space. And already a lot of the polling places near us are at or near capacity for voters, so I just want to make sure that should any action be taken, we work closely with the election commission to ensure that no voters will be disenfranchised while this transition occurs. Thank you very much for your consideration.
Our next speaker signed up is Susan Rubin.
Since 2013, talking about Jefferson, it's the first time I've come up here with no prepared statement. I'm tired. I know you guys are tired too. I think I'm just going to stick with my tennis analogy from last time. That said, match point. Here we are. Please step up to the baseline. Go for the ace. It's time. They need it. Stephanie, I love you. You're wonderful. It's back. Please, hold this through. And I also just want to say, kind of issues to your entries. I just want to say thank you for allowing the students to peaceful protest today. My sixth grader participated, which I'm so proud of him. On his own accord, I talked to him this morning about it, and I said, you do what's comfortable for you. And he didn't participate in that incident, so I just want to say thank you for supporting that. Thank you.
Yeah, Carol Moss.
Carol Moss, District 200 resident. Good evening. First, I'd like to implore the administration for their transparency for listing on the agenda number 7, the professional learning expenditure for board members for board approval. It would be fantastic if all expenditures for board members and administrators at the service center be attached to future agendas for board approval. I did review the high school textbook and would like to make a comment. Under continuing relevance of the Constitution, and adapting to changes, it stated that the U.S. Constitution is a living document capable of meeting the needs of Americans. I don't see it as a living document, but as a static document with something to change. That's the only thing I can find wrong with the textbook. And the reason why? Well, I looked at movement phase at high school. I had two students there. I think what happened in Florida a month ago was horrible and done by one person. The movement today across the country was about politically organizing. I am for the First Amendment, freedom of speech, but this movement was all about going after the Second Amendment, the right to bear arms. Upon further discussion, I understand that the Wheaton North students use this day to recognize the issue facing students across the country and make good use of the time by working on solutions they feel would help the situation. In one of my girls' classes, about half the class got up and left at 10 a.m., effectively ending the class for that period. The teacher stated the curriculum will resume again tomorrow. So obviously we lost, you know, curriculum time in class. I think the administration should stop any further disruptions during the school day. If the students want to express their First Amendment rights, they can meet before or after school or during their free time during school, but not during class time. Lastly, a few comments on the lease certificates. I did ask a question at last week's finance meeting, how can we construct a building without referendum? I was told if it was leased, or donate, it does not need approval. Upon further review, section 10.10-22.36 of the school code states permission is required for voters to build a school. It does not say finance a school. When this bill was debated on the 74 on May 1st, 2001, one of the representatives asked, I want to make sure that we're not circumventing the right of voters to say, I don't think you ought to buy that building. And the reply was, this is not a bill, we're talking about leasing. Many school districts lease a building, maybe for a dollar an hour, to be sure that it's not something that needs to be done by with referendum. So we're not changing that part. We're just gaining dollars needed for a school district that most definitely has still have to go to referendum. This law, when it was passed back in 2001, was never intended to circumvent the obligation of a referendum for construction. So I hope the board has the courage to table the vote tonight and get better legal counsel on whether or not the leasing certificates are actually legal in this situation. And if the school board, the school district needs to go to referendum to have Jefferson built before, you know, going for a leasing certificates. So I do agree that we do need new Jefferson, but however, I think we need to make sure that the direction we are going is, you know, legally viable.
The next item on the agenda is the superintendent's report. Dr. Short.
Thank you, Mr. Brumman. Just a couple of things that I want to share with the board tonight. When I started, as we did our recognition of the National Merit Scholars by entering the foundation and sponsoring the generous reception that we did beforehand, again, thank you for that. One of the things that I wanted to bring and share with the board tonight, and I'll send this around, last week, I think it was the Wheaton Chamber of Commerce did their Best of Wheaton Awards. And one of the areas of recognition this year were for innovative programs in the area of economic development. And they recognized three different entities in the community that started programs that have a potential economic benefit to the community. One of those was the Business Incubator program that's taking place both at Wheaton North and Wheaton Warrenville South. So I have both the award that the district received for the incubator program, as well as a little write-up in the program about it. And we were joined at that honor by several of the community members that were instrumental in bringing that program together, as well as our high school teachers and administrators that really thought outside the box to bring that opportunity to fruition this year, and could not be more proud of that opportunity. So I'll send that around for board members to look at. I want to remind you that this Friday is our, Erica, is it our fourth Facebook Live event?
Yeah.
Our fourth Facebook Live event. What we're going to be giving the community a glimpse of this Friday at the Facebook Live event are some of the new classroom configurations, furniture configurations, environment configurations that teachers and schools have sought to create. So we're going to be highlighting from a number of different schools some new learning environment configurations that I think, again, will be a great opportunity for the community to get a glimpse of. When we talk about learning environments, when we talk about items like other learning centers and classrooms, it's hard to understand that without getting, I think, a firsthand glimpse of how is the learning environment matching the learning that's taking place inside those classrooms. So if you're available, join us this Friday for that Facebook Live event. Over the weekend, we had a couple of phenomenal community events hosted at a number of our schools. I was here on Saturday for a show choir event that brought groups from all around the state, all around the country, in to showcase the talents of our students in show choir. Really a phenomenal opportunity, and what I'm always reminded of when we host opportunities like that is not just the talent of our students, they're clearly very, very talented, but it takes an incredible community to pull opportunities like that off. I could not believe how many parents, community members were here working and bringing that opportunity to fruition, so thank you for that. I also know last week that Franklin Middle School did the dodgeball tournament that, again, raises a lot of money for charity, but one of our elementary principals this week reminded me, this is the first time I went to that, and that really has become just a, it's a community event, the amount of folks that it brings together, again, around a common cause, I think are very, very positive. And then finally, I just want to take a quick second to mention, I shared with the board a little earlier today, and I know our middle and high school principals sent out notes to their communities today about some of the student activities that did take place inside of our schools. And I was at Wheaton North today and had an opportunity to listen in to some of the activities that students had designed and created that represented their voice. And one of the things that I was intrigued about, and I just want to share, is that I think there were a number of reasons why students were participating in that opportunity today. Some wanted to talk about showing support to a community that clearly had suffered a very significant loss. Others wanted to talk about how it is that they might be able to engage in meaningful reform at the state or legislative level. Others wanted to offer ideas about how we make our own communities safer, not just in the physical arrangement of our schools, but most importantly in how it is that we make sure we support students in our schools to feel valued, feel a part of our school community, and not feel compelled to perhaps take other activities. And so I'm proud of the student voice that was represented today. I'm proud of the fact that the school district, I think, found a balance around providing that opportunity. We had students from both of our high schools a little earlier this week that took a field trip to another high school in the area where I think about 400 high school students came together to really engage in thoughtful dialogue around how to make a difference. And it was not simply a political act that was being referenced in that. I think it was true dialogue around how do we make sure that our communities are safe for the future of our communities. So I just wanted to mention that to the board. Activities at all our schools were peaceful, organized, thoughtful, student-led. And I think that says a lot for the student voice and existence in our schools. So that's all I have for tonight.
Any questions, comments, or Dr. Schwartz? Hearing none, we'll go on to the consent agenda. Please bear with me here. Item number one, acceptance of this from the Monroe Middle School PTA. Two, approve posting revised policy 7.40 for public review and comment. Three, approval of high school in the United States history textbook. Four, approval of Title I money for Wheaton, Pleasantville, Sanford, Baltimore, and Washington. Five, approval of ROE building permit applications for Wheaton North High School and Lowell Elementary School. Six, approval to dispose of surplus assets. Seven, approval of professional learning expense request for board members. Eight, approval of activity vehicle lease bid. Nine, approval of network-wide filtering fiber service. 10, approval of network hardware purchase. 11, approval of resolutions or authorized transfer for them to be payable to fund loan, close friend, and working cash fund, education fund. 12, approval of resolutions or authorized transfer for them to be payable to fund loan, close friend, and working cash fund to IMRF fund. 13, approval of auditor services. 14, approval of bills payable and payroll. 15, approval of minutes, February 14, 2018, open and closed. February 28, 2018, Committee of the Whole, and approval to destroy recordings of closed sessions prior to October 2016 as allowable by law. And 16, approval of personnel reports to include employment, resignation, retirement, and leave of absence of administrative, certified, classified, and non-union staff. Are there any items board members want to move from the consent agenda? Hearing none, Dr. Schwartz.
And just a couple of quick comments on the consent agenda items. Number one, the acceptance of a gift from Monroe PTA. That's a gift value of about $8,000. So again, we continue to be very thankful for the support of our groups that generously raise money to support our schools. So thank you for that. Two, I wanted to mention that there are a couple of items on the consent agenda that directly relate to the master technology plan update that the board heard a couple of meetings ago, your committee of the whole. So those are a couple of the purchases that, again, you heard about at that that presentation. So, you know, those are big items, important items. The board certainly had an opportunity to learn about those a little while back. And then finally, I just want to mention there are a couple of resolutions to authorize transfers from within our funds. This is an annual process that takes place in the cycle of the school district. There's always a cash flow window based on the fact that we get a tax payment at the very beginning of the school year. We get one in May, and so not uncommon, but this is the reason why you have a fund balance policy that reserves 25%, so that you have the ability to work through the cash flow of the district. And I think the question was asked, and just like you mentioned, we are in a much better cash position this year than we were at this time last year, thanks to the fact that there has been a little bit of a catch up again within the state payments and in the new state funding cycle. We're getting more money on a regular basis this year than we were getting in the past. So that's all I have.
Are there any questions or comments about Shula or Stan? Number one, I just want to make it clear on the reason that as always, there are a number of emails that are directed to the superintendent that respond to all of us on the board relating particularly to the consent agenda. I would prefer that to happen at this meeting with Julia, but you know, to kind of reiterate a couple of those items that caught my attention. Number one was the again borrowing. That's again normal course. It's later this year. And the reason it's later is partially because of fund balance, but it's also the state is paying is more current, which is good news. The state, regular state payments include things that we used to get, literally 9 months later. In that same question, though, I'm curious of what, at the end of December, there's a large amount of people, because of the change in the tax law, that paid their real estate taxes early. Have we heard anything from the tax collector on how that money will be distributed? There's obviously a lot of interest being earned on it, but we got to share that interest and so on.
Mr. Father, you want to address that? I know you've had some conversation.
Sure. We have checked in with the county. They are going to do a distribution in May, I believe May 15th, and they are going to distribute the interest earnings proportionate to each taxing body as much as they make up the total tax bill for DuPage County. So we are anticipating that payment in May.
Any more questions or comments about Shula or Stan?
An observation on number four, the Title I plans for the five elementary schools. So first, thank you for pursuing the additional grant. But it's interesting that if you include those five schools plus Johnson, six of our 13, almost half of our elementary schools have almost a third low-income students. And it's just representative of the kind of changing demographic of our communities, which is very valuable, I think, to our student experience, as we saw tonight with the students across the high school. So I really value that, and I appreciate it. It's kind of eye-opening that it's definitely a change within our community for the positive.
And for those of residents who may not have read the Title I plans, some of the Title I students in these schools range from 33 to almost 39% of the student population. Just to clarify that, what are the Title I students?
Percent of low income. So if they have a percent of low income, makes them Title I schools and thus available to receive Title I funds, which is federal money.
And Title I funds are federal money,
correct.
Question on
that
for math coaches, because I know our math coaches, if you are a Title I school, you have to be a full-time math coach.
Uh, I don't believe so. Those schools were Title I schools. I think the resolution that you see shifts the way that we're approaching the distribution of the Title I funds. So these are not schools that were not qualifying as Title I schools, but the percent of low income has risen to the point that we have a little more flexibility in how the grant is applied to those schools. That's what the resolution for those schools. We had that ability at Johnson. We now have the ability at the other five schools who were in the draft plans.
So then that grant money could be used to say toward math coaches, correct?
Right. Could, yeah.
One other question. Again, this is addressing some of the emails that I had occurred. Rob, you had a number of questions about the technology-based issue. Could you kind of reiterate what your concern was with this comment?
So I posed a question about, we reviewed the master technology plan in the previous committee of the whole, and that has kind of high-level direction, high-level guidance, and do we have detailed documents, strategic documents behind it, a schedule of assets and their expected life, a detailed technology plan behind it, and the response was yes. And so I was really pleased to see that and understand that. And the expenditures tonight are going to be around connectivity and network pipes, which is critical to our schools, for our kids need more access, right? And there's no shortage of devices and no shortage of a growing population of online activity going on in schools. So I'm really pleased to see we're making these investments. But I'm really pleased to see that it's part of an overall detail plan, and it's not a spot spend, right? It's a strategic spend. And just a real kudos to Rob and the team for putting this together. And I want to make sure this is part of this overall strategic detail plan. Great job. Wow.
Any other comments or questions? If not, I'm asking for a motion and a second to approve the consent agenda as presented.
Second.
Second.
Moved by Mrs. Crabtree, seconded by Mr. Matheson. Please call the roll.
Mrs. Crabtree?
Yes.
Mr. Matheson?
Yes.
Mrs. Erickson?
Yes.
Mr. Gambiani?
Yes.
Mr. Hanlon?
Yes.
Mr. Paulson?
Yes.
Mr. Roman?
Yes, the consent agenda is passed. Next, we now go to action items. The next item for consideration is the resolution approving the execution of the lease and escrow agreement among the district of Lessee. ZB National Association doing business design bank for the lessor and Amalgamated Bank Chicago as escrow agent with respect to an early childhood center located within the district's boundaries pursuant to the provisions of section 10-22.12 and section 10-22.36 of the school code of the state of Illinois as amended, and that the board will consider the adoption of said resolution. Mrs. Crabtree, would you please read the resolution by title?
Resolution authorizing and providing for a lease agreement for the purpose of building and equipping a new early childhood center in and for Community Unit School District Number 200, DuPage County, Illinois.
And Dr. Schubert?
Sure, just with the approval of the lease agreement tonight, I want to set a little context both for the board and for those in the community that may or not have been a regular part of this conversation. So work on the agreement that's presented tonight for board approval has taken place over several board meetings. This is going back a number of months, and I just want to give you a quick recap of that history. Following the referendum discussion, community survey almost a year ago, the Board of Education prioritized three areas out of the master facility plan. Those areas included secure entries, capital improvement work, and early learning. I do want to remind you that the highest priority capital improvement work that you have is at Jefferson, where we've got almost $5.2 million for the stuff that needs to be fixed in that building now. And I think the board wisely made a decision that simply in investing in fixing infrastructure in a building that wasn't serving the needs of students did not make sense, and so we did go back to the drawing board to look at options for how we could address that facility. The board explored a number of options, and with input from the community, narrowed the options to two. That included building an addition at Monroe, and funding that through debt certificates, or two, construct a new building on the existing site through a lease agreement. The primary interest, I think, in most on the board was in making sure that we address two issues: the issue of cost of the facility and how it was that that facility was going to be funded. The building is being constructed at this point at a reasonable cost. Appropriate cost, we reduced the size and the scope of the building to contain the cost, and is being funded without adding to the tax burden of the community. The lease agreement clearly says that. After a fair amount of analysis and feedback from the community considering the options, the board did narrow their focus to the lease agreement on the existing site. There are two sections in the school code that were read right in the resolution that pertain to the ability of the school district to lease the building. That's our 10-22-12, which pertains to the ability of the school district to enter into a lease agreement, and 10-22-36, that's the section of the school code that sets requirement for when a referendum is required. And I just want to read one paragraph out of the school code. This is straight out of the school code where it talks about referendum. Notwithstanding any of the foregoing, no referendum shall be required if the purchase, construction, or building of any such building occurs while the building is being leased by the school district or is paid with funds derived from the sale or disposition of other buildings, land, and structures of the school district, or funds received as a grant under school construction law. So what we're presenting to the board tonight is a lease agreement. Certainly in our evaluation and interpretation, the recommendation is fully compliant with the school code language. In January, the board received an overview of the concept of a lease agreement and how it works. In February, we reviewed a draft of the lease agreement and an opinion of counsel from Chapman and Cutler. We've continued to make some adjustments in the lease agreement based on input from both legal and financial counsel, and are here this evening with a recommendation to approve the escrow lease agreement. This was reviewed with Finance Committee last week, and I do want to affirm, I mean, based on a question from the Finance Committee, there's clear language that we have no authority to raise an additional tax connected with this lease agreement. The initial payment into the escrow account will come from proceeds from the capital development board, those are school construction dollars, and the annual payment will come from our operating budget that was projected in the budget or in the financial projections you reviewed in January. So with the input of the Finance Committee, we've set the lease term to 20 years. Once the final cost of the building construction is determined, and only once the board is fully comfortable with the cost of the building, will the lease certificates be sold and the final lease payment will be determined. So we've given you in your green folders an updated copy. It's the same lease agreement that was attached to the board agenda. The one difference is Amalgamated Bank has been identified in the lease agreement as the escrow agent that will manage the funds for Zions Bank. Otherwise, the lease agreement that's in your package is what was presented to you before. And so my recommendation this evening is that the board approve the lease agreement and move us forward with this project.
Are there any questions or comments from the board?
I have another question. So the first lease payment would not happen, if I remember correctly, from the last meeting, would be before that until the building is built.
No, so there is an initial lease payment that will happen within the next 30 days. So upon execution of the lease, there was an initial payment of $1.5 million that will go into the escrow account. And then the payments, so the payments will be twice annual. I think there would be a January of 2019, where's Bob Lewis? June of 2019 payments. So I mean, close to the end of construction, but the lease payment will only be once the cost of construction are known. So there's construction that may still be taking place, but the cost of construction is going to be fully known so that the bank is aware of their cost to build the building.
So is that kind of like payment down payment for the work to be done? And then the actual lease payment will be determined once we have that.
Correct. Okay. There are some early cost that the bank is going to incur in the final design cost of the building as the project's getting ready to go out to bid, thus the reason for the structure with an early payment to the bank.
So an actual payment versus a down payment?
Is an actual payment.
Does that payment not go into an escrow though?
Goes into an escrow.
So it's not being spent or paid to interest or anything like that. That's money that's available to pay bills as they become due related to the building to be leased.
Correct.
Okay, so it's not leaving our, technically our pocket. It's in a...
It is leaving our pocket.
Well, it is.
It's being paid to escrow.
Technically, if we didn't move forward, we're not going to... We would be able to recover a substantial amount of $1.5 million.
Yeah, so to clarify that. So clearly, in the language in the lease payment, it makes it clear that if ultimately, for whatever reason, the project went out to bid and not comfortable with ultimately the cost, which would then impact obviously the cost of the lease. If the lease certificates are not issued by the end of the calendar year, is that correct? Then there is no lease, then the lease goes away. Any money that's not been spent out of that escrow account will return to the district. So there will be some early costs around design of the building. But if in fact, you know, the building does not happen, any escrow, unspent escrow money will return to the district.
You mentioned the capital development board. What is their role in this?
District 200 received dollars under the school construction grant, which was issued by the Capital Development Board. That's what established the fund balance that we currently have within the school district. So that initial payment that's going into this project of $1.5 million, that it, in essence coming out of fund balance, it's Capital Development Board dollars that will return to the district what year, Bill? What year? 2012 in the school construction dollars.
That was that $14 million.
Correct.
Okay, so that was,
we spent about $2 or $3 million of that. The balance still remains in our fund.
Okay, so what you're saying is that the fund balance has been developed primarily by the recovery of that $14 million in the past. Okay, that was roughly 5 years ago.
Okay.
All right. So the Capital Development Board is no longer involved. They're not overseeing this project in any way.
Okay,
so, all right. A couple other issues. Number one, this is not committing us to go forward until we get final numbers on the cost of what may have to be contributed by the district above and beyond whatever amount we finance. The amount we're not financed that we enter into leasing. This lease agreement is based on $14 million, I believe. And we still have not technically concluded whether we can draw all $14 million or not, based again on construction costs and so on. Okay. So, and also the balance of any above the cost of that would come from fund balance or in this case the capital development. Okay. Just to be clear, I've seen a lot of activity about legal opinions and so on. Okay. I just want to be clear. We have our legal attorneys look at this and modify these words. Okay. We have two banks involved, or at least one, Zions Bank, who is the somehow distributor, the leaseholder, I don't know if that's the right word. But, and in addition, whoever is going to be marketing these, ultimately someone buys these certificates for investment. And individuals could be those people, institutions, whoever it may be. Each one of those parties is obviously looking at this from a legal sense. And they're, if I buy a bond from General Motors, I get a whole, a big certificate about it and explains all the procedures and the legal obligations. So through this process, we are at the point where those reviews of all those legal authorities are called have occurred. Is that a fair statement? Right. Do we lease any other buildings out of curiosity? And if we did we ask for that referendum page?
The only other space that we lease is for the transition center. We would lease some space on near Bridge Street.
Do we have a referendum for that out of curiosity?
We do not.
Right. Yeah, the legal opinion is going to be given by Chapman College on
to the 3 years we passed for all of our bonds, at least from my experience. And they are probably premium offering in Chicago on municipal and public bonding. So that a few members will be available to post on bond these certificates, design bank, and to us.
Another question. We're not the first school district to go down this route, correct? So this is, there is a history of other school districts doing this as well.
There's a history of lease agreements going back a lot, but we're certainly not the first.
One other comment. If we, let's say that we're on a target to have this building begun to be constructed on our behalf. That we released. And the target of that is when? What is the target time?
The target timeline is to have it open by the fall of the 2019 school year. So construction would take place likely beginning late summer and carry through the next school year. So by the start of the 2019 school year, it will be open.
Okay. And I guess, you know, I recall just going through the history of the, called the Jefferson Project, we started, I'm going to say, what was it, 2012, maybe gone back earlier than that, but there was a specific referendum on the building of the Jefferson, nearly known as Center Building. That was defeated, and that was a very large building. As I recall, it was about 60,000 square feet. Then, as part of a referendum that occurred, a referendum request, question, whatever you want to call it, that occurred in last year, I guess, the 2 years ago, I'm losing track of time here. But that was part of a, potentially part of a $150 million, $160 million program that would have raised taxes at, you know, some amount based on the average house and so on. And so Jefferson was not a specific yes or no question there. It was about the entire project. And one could contend that some of that fund balance was being used to finance the Jefferson. Okay, so, and then thirdly, when we are now where we're at here, so we really haven't had a no vote other than that 60,000 square foot building back in the day. Where are we at right now on what we're looking at under this program? What kind of square footage are we looking at?
A little over 40,000.
Okay, so this school board, which is principally this group that's been involved with it for the last 4 or 5 or 6 years now, or has basically listened to the community, said that that may have been too big a building. We now modify that to roughly two-thirds of the size. And in addition, we're not using any new tax. We're not seeking debt service money. It's coming out of operating money and so on. Is that fair? Okay, last question then. Let's say that, you know, this, you know, for whatever reason, this was challenged, you know, and it delayed construction of this project. What would be the impact of that? My own opinion would be we would incur interest, or let me say to you, we would incur inflationary costs for whatever that delay is. And as I recall, some of the back when numbers at 60,000 were not far from where we're at right today. I mean, there are some modifications to it, but inflation has caused that to happen already. So if we would continue down this path, and let's say we couldn't start this for another year, we would have inflationary costs going into this whole project. Is that right? And I believe we're also on the verge of higher interest rates. Clearly the federal government, or the Federal Reserve, has been taking interest rates up. And, you know, so we're still somewhat in an opportunity here. We missed the goal a little bit already, I believe. But, you know, if that continued to occur, we could potentially have higher interest rates that would affect us as well. So any delay in this project would be, you know, significant, in my opinion. It would be both inflationary and interest rate sensitive and so on. So I guess what I'm getting at is I strongly support. I feel comfortable with what we've done. I feel comfortable with the pattern of what we've done. I feel that we have evaluated this. I still am concerned about the cost. And not ready to commit the whole thing, but surely this lease is not going to be the deterrent that I would say in this whole project or moving forward. So I think we have to get this behind us. You know, literally, I think there was reference tonight about this has been going on for, I don't know how many years, but you know, I know it's been as long as I've been on the board, which is now 5+ years. So You know, I would like to put this behind us in a more real positive framework related to this versus what I call the academic.
All right. Well, yeah, thanks. I was not on the board when we put forth the last referendum. We just recently joined the board. And I'd really like to share my thoughts on why I'm going to vote the way I vote. You know, we do, as a board, training through the ISP and other groups, and that's part of our guidance that we see training, we see input. And one of the pieces that came out of there is people should explain why they're going to vote the way they vote. And I like that. And since I've been part of the conversation over the course of X number of years, as many of my board partners have been, I want to talk about why I vote we need to vote yes, and why I'm going to vote yes. First is, we looked at the survey results from the outcome of the referendum. And I believe those survey results, in my opinion, were clear that the defeat of the referendum was about taxes, not about building the early 97. And so I feel very comfortable with the feedback of that survey and hearing the comments from the public as well. I've heard many comments from the public. I've listened to them at many meetings. Second is, as Mr. Matheson pointed out, and Dr. Schuler shared, we sought the opinion of counsel more than one time, more than one case. And I believe that appeared talking us through publicly their points of view. And so I feel very, the question has been raised several times about the legality. I have no question about that. I feel very comfortable with the counsel we sought, that we've done it diligently, we've done it more than once with multiple partners. Third, we've seen a pattern of commentary, not just from within our district, but outside our district. And I believe that is commentary focused on taxes, not on should you build a building for a millennium. And in fact, we've heard multiple times from folks that oppose the tax increase that we believe we need a millennium center. And so I feel very comfortable we're representing both people that are for the referendum as well as those that are against the referendum. And then lastly, one of the questions I've asked through the email process we have is why is Zion's Bank? And I think it's important to talk about this. And I'm just going to kind of read the response because I thought it was set up well. So I asked a question about the process and how we get to about Zion's Bank. Zion's Bank was identified by PMA, our district financial advisor, as a bank who has been a lessor in previous lease agreements in Illinois. And looking for a lessor, it was recommended by PMA that the institution be large, secure, and along with being a lessor in prior agreements, Zion's Bank fit that criteria. And I thought that was really well stated. And we've heard from Zion's Bank as well, they presented to this board. So I'm happy with that decision. And then, you know, lastly, having been in the school, we've had our, being a member of the facilities committee, and just even a short amount of time that I've been on the board, there's no doubt in my mind that need is there. There's just no question. And so I want to make it clear why I'm voting yes. I want to say that I strongly support this, and it wasn't arrived at in a short amount of time. I really thought through those issues, and I really thought through and pressure tested each one of those points I made. And I know that other board members have done that as well. And so this is not a rubber stamp. It has been really pressure tested, and I really appreciate the work the board has done, and the team has done to pull this information together. So thank you for the time.
Any other comments, thoughts from board members?
Okay, so since Rob aided me into explaining my own vote, yes. And I think well, first off, before I say that, just one question on Exhibit A, and I'll come back to my class. Exhibit A is lease payments, which are a little bit different than what we talked about in the past, which is a fixed payment every year. This starts a little bit lower and then kind of incrementally goes up. Can we talk about the logic of why that is? Which I support that because I think that provides us some strategic time to figure out if this is our budget.
That's okay. Just to let you want to come up and just kind of talk a little bit about the work behind the structure of the payment schedule.
What you see there is that these payments are the principal component. The interest component is added to it, it creates a level of overall payment.
One other item I had on that, real quickly, when we talk about the finance committee
know, we talk about, we've talked in the past about a 15-year versus a, you know, a 20-year model. We're going to 20-year model as a recommendation through the Finance Committee, I guess. But, you know, again, just to kind of make sure we got some, in the amount as well, up to 14 million or less than, you know, because we still are confronted with, you know, significant, as you know from the Finance Committee, funding costs that we're going to have to deal with. So this could free up a little more of the fund balance available for other construction needs as well.
Okay. So now I'll continue with my comments. And first off, why would we vote yes? This kind of goes back to what I brought up to people that went to the Warrenville School at the last meeting, maybe it was the meeting before that, where I talked about kids, and I was trying to use that as my anchor point for how do we make a right decision to put kids in the environment that they need. And I'm not going to press anybody, whether it's on the board or in the community, that doesn't agree that the current learning environment in Jefferson does not provide the right learning environment for our students and does not provide the right facilities to let our teachers and staff do everything they need to. Now, I know we have good performance, but through my career and research in the building industry and working almost exclusively for my 23 years on educational facilities, I do know that the learning environment, the facility, does have a direct impact on efficiency, the opportunities that kids get, the type of environment they're in to do their best for. So, there's no doubt that's important. So that's my number one anchor. That's why I'm going to vote yes. I'll echo, I think everybody here that I, first off, thank you to the administration for all the hard work that's been done working with different attorneys, different banks, reviewing design contracts and construction management contracts to make sure all these different agreements are kind of integrated and not integrated together, but connected in terms of the terms and conditions. I know that we have, that is, not only this the right solution from a physical standpoint, but the right solution from a financial standpoint to make this work. And you know, there's a disbelief out there if you look at social media or other comments that this is going to raise taxes. It's clearly not. We're paying for this with the money we had or have through our fund balance. We're paying this through future operating levies, which is exactly what we've been doing for years, to figure out how to do this with the money we have. So I'm very confident that the approach we've taken, which will not raise taxes for the community, won't add to our bottom line. That this is the right solution. And then finally, I think, you know, this entire solution has been driven around community feedback. If you think about what happens after the referendum, we did the survey, basically, in my words, figured out that don't raise our taxes, which was what we've done. We evaluated, I think, 7 or 8 different solutions, narrowed it down to. We talked to the park district about a grant park solution. We listened to that community who had concerns about that, what that solution would do to their experience within the community, their use of the grant park. So we looked at a different solution, building the existing building south of Jefferson. We heard from that community about green space and the location of the building. We responded to that. So I think through this entire process, you know, certainly going back to the April of 2017, the feedback we've been hearing from the community has shaped us and kind of guided us in everything we've done. And so I think kind of those would be the point about kids and getting them right in the market and listening to feedback from the community and working so diligently with all the experts we hire as a school district to shape, put us in the right direction. I'm very excited about this solution. I know it's going to be the right solution for the community, for the students, and I'm ready to go on this end.
Any other comments or thoughts? On behalf of the board, for the first time in 2011, my number one advisor and counselor, my wife Susan, said what you ought to do now is you run for election to the board for the first time as visitor of the school and talk to the principal. And it gave me the opportunity to visit for the first time Jefferson because my children, by the time Jefferson opened up, were too old to attend Jefferson. And that's when I met Stephanie for the first time and saw Jefferson. And like all of you, the first time you see Jefferson, you know right away that this is totally inadequate for an early childhood learning center. And supported the first referendum back in 2012. We supported the referendum 2 years ago. And then with PMA and its council on this opportunity to use these certificates to those, they couldn't comply with the survey we got, the result we got last year. And it was like a godsend. And I've read the provisions in the school code that apply. I have some experience as an attorney, providing the legal opinion and all, but I'm comfortable that we're in compliance with the school code. I'm very comfortable with the way this has come about, and again, like all of you, I commend our superintendent, our senior leadership team, and the entire staff, including Stephanie and the staff at Jefferson, all the work they've done. And I'm delighted to support this motion. Any other comments? Hearing none, I ask for a motion and a second to approve the resolution as presented and read by title. So
second.
Mr. Matheson and a second by Mrs. Erickson, Mrs. Hutchinson. Would you please call the roll?
Mr. Matheson?
Yes.
Mrs. Erickson?
Yes.
Mrs. Crabtree?
Yes.
Mr. Damiani?
Yes.
Mr. Hamlin?
Yes.
Mr. Paulson?
Yes. Yes, the motion passes unanimous. The motion carried and several resolution adopted by the former board of school boards. The unanimous board approved to sign the same and directed the secretary to report the same in full and the records of the board of community union school district number 200 in Page County, Illinois. Now we move to second action item.
So quickly, I want to thank Bob Lewis for all his work that he's done. Kind of guided us through this process.
Thank you.
Thanks, Bob.
Well said. Action item number two, approval of bids for 2018 facility improvements, secure amenities, or on the top one, Dr. Schubert.
Yeah, so my introduction to the Early Learning Center really also set a foundation for this. Second priority established about a way a year ago was to move forward and address the secure entries. The facility committee has worked with us to move this work forward along with the architect who's been our architect on this project. A little over a month ago, we did put out bids for the secure entry work for eight of our facilities as along with a component of the capital work that's being done this summer. There is still a bid that's out for some paving work. That's another significant chunk of the work that's scheduled to get done this summer. But in total, between the bid that we're bringing to you for recommendation for approval tonight, and the balance of the capital work that's still out to bid, we anticipate, we expected to budget about $4.2 million in total for that work. 3.2 of that will come out of next year's operating budget. The balance will come out of fund balance, which was one of the conversations that we had around completing the secure entries. And I think it goes without question, but certainly recent events around security, I think, remind us of the importance to make sure that we do everything that we can to protect the safety of our schools. And so I applaud the board for having made this a priority. Mr. Farley, any additional comments that you want to make on the topic? And just one thing, is this comes up sometimes in questions. So when we put work out to bid, our responsibility under the law is to accept the lowest responsive bidder. Right? We don't always have to take the low bid. And we get asked that question, what happens if you have a contractor that clearly is not capable of completing the work? You have to accept their bid. We did, in fact, have a contractor on this project who was deemed non-responsive in their inability to provide references similar work. And so with the work of our architects and legal counsel, we did, in fact, determine them not to be a responsive bidder. And so that's the recommendation that we move forward with what's in front of you. So Brad, Rob, any comments from Facilities Committee?
Well, I guess two things. This is part of that same referendum question that was voted down by the community. So But we all know as a board that this, you know, these are critical, super critical things that we continue to pursue with this, the eight schools will get some better insurance. All of our schools will get that secure investment over a period. A visitor, you're walking into the main office, you're forced directly into the main office before you're going to the school. That's the objective of this. Second, really isn't a facility issue, but you know, I've been meeting in a lot of these waters professionally, so I just want to be as totally transparent as possible every time I feel like I need to. LJ Morris, the recommended bidder, does work with my company. I've never personally worked with LJ Morris. They do work as a contractor with my company. The owner of the company does have a daughter who works for my company, so there's a little bit of affection. I have no, obviously, financial interest in this, but I'm always going to err on the side of transparency to make sure there's no issues out there. Confident that there's nothing there on that one this thing for those reasons. I just want to be told clear.
Any other questions? John?
Have you used this company before? Do you have any kind of past relationship with them?
I'm sorry, I wasn't
Have we used this construction company?
Yes.
They were in a general contract package on Hubble, so we have worked with them in the past. And they
provide
other projects as well.
And notice that items 1, 5, 6, and 7 were excluded from this. And 7 was alternative access control, not on our working set.
Yeah. The Washington Minister Roman was questioning what was pulled out. Reason for that. Jim has said in year two of the capital plan, there's significant mechanical work at that building, and so it was determined that while the controls are in desperate need of updating at that building, it just simply made more sense to do the controls at the same point that you're replacing the mechanical system.
I'm questioning, what is the secure entry? Again, I know that it requires the buzzing and so on. Is there I'll call it panic alarm in even these schools that are doing or other schools? I mean, somehow there has to be some notification, but if something were to happen, how do we then notify the authorities or the
So secure entry accomplishes two things inside of each of our buildings. Our buildings have right now access control. So you cannot get into a building without somebody buzzing you into the building, right? That controls access. Second security feature, though, that we want to achieve is visitor control. So once you're let into the building, we want to know what you're there for and where you're going inside the building. And the way to achieve that is to make sure when somebody comes in the building, they immediately go into the office where we know why they're there and can direct them to where they need to be. Your question about do buildings have and that's not part of this security, that's not part of the secure entry feature. We do have some separate security features that are in place within our schools, but that's not part of the secure entry piece. What we're accomplishing through this fix is that access control at buildings.
Would it be appropriate to have some kind of, I guess, you were saying there is some way that there would be notification if something were to happen to the authorities, I guess, can we conclude that in there? I'm thinking of a buzzer, a bank buzzer concept, I don't know how involved that is, but it's something that to me is kind of, the next step in the spirit, I guess, you would hope that we give that some consideration.
There's multiple layers of things that you think about this secure entrance is kind of one of the basic things. I know that a lot of school districts now are doing this exact thing they've been doing for years, but it seems like there's more and more urgency to get everything covered. But there are other systems that we can look at, such as what you're talking about. I know we have a closed session in the middle talk about secure corridor schools. So. I know many school districts are using that authority to talk about these things, which are probably best after the closed session. The answer to your question is yes, but that's just one of many things that we need to do.
Okay.
Any questions, comments from the board members? If not, I ask for a motion and second to approve the bids for 2018 facility improvements for secure entries, flooring, and ductwork as presented.
Move.
So moved by Mr. Hammond.
Second.
Seconded by Mr. Paulson. Mrs. Hutchinson, would you please call the roll?
Mr. Hammond?
Yes.
Mr. Paulson?
Yes.
Mrs. Crabtree?
Yes.
Mrs. Erickson?
Yes.
Mr. Gambiani?
Yes.
Mr. Madison?
Yes.
Yes. A motion to approve bids for 2018 facility improvements for secure entries, flooring, and ductwork as presented. It's passed. Action item number three, approval of CUSD200 services for custodial cleaning services contract renewal. Dr. Schuler.
Mr. Farley, any additional information you want to share with the board back on this one?
Thank you, Dr. Schuler. Well, we are asking the board to do a one-year renewal of CUSD services. We have the ability to do on a year basis based on the CPI parameters, CPI parameters that we have for our lobbying capabilities. And we always, on an annual basis, review the level of service and expectations for GCA. And John Robinson and his crew work with GCA very closely. They've come back with a renewal that's under the CPI, cited in the CPI from the most recent levy. So based on quality and service that we receive from GCA, we're recommending a one-year view renewal.
So this is the third one-year renewal we've done with GCA? Right, and I understand working within the CPI increase, good service, performance, no turnover, or minimal having turnover staff. But we keep negotiating with the same company, so we're kind of baking in that CPI increase that we're allowed to do. At what point in the multi-year agreement we decide, hey, let's open this up and see if there's a competitive thing that might allow us to look at everything? Is that at some point we do, or we just keep going one year after one year after one year?
Yeah, and so certainly, ultimately, the board can provide that direction. My perspective on that issue, I guess number one, I'm going to remind you that the last outsource contract you put out to bid actually resulted in a significant cost increase that is well beyond the increase that you're seeing in this one. So, in my view, two triggers that I think would drive you to determine it's time to put the contract back out to bid. Obviously, number one is if we're not happy with the service, if we're not getting the service that we need in terms of keeping buildings clean and appropriately servicing our buildings, then giving that a tame conversation about a renewal, I think you put it out the bid. If we're happy with the service and believe they continue to deliver per the contract and per our expectations, then we explore the conversation around renewal. And if the cost is at a level that we have concern with or believe is beyond a reasonable increase to the contract and based on cost, you choose to put it out. I think in this particular circumstance this year, service is good. We're happy with the quality of the service that they're providing. And I continue to think that the cost is reasonable for the contract. We did achieve savings when you outsourced this service when that original decision was made. And so I think as long as we continue to manage the increase, you're still getting value out of it.
I'd ask a question about does doing a series of one-year extensions discourage people from participating in bids? Right? Will it shrink the pool of potential bidders whenever we do decide to take it out? I was thinking a lot about that. And just going to go back to what kind of the list of the FOIA history. If you look at FOIA, there's a lot of requests for bids, there's a lot of requests for information about bids, a lot of requests asking about what our spend is in various areas. And so I don't believe we're discouraging the pool of potential bidders. I think there's so much competition out there, and people are very hungry. And so the only other aspect I thought about is this really diluting our pool. But I would expect if we decide to in the future, we're not going to see a shortage of bidders.
We get contacted from time to time from prospective vendors of cleaning services, and you know, when this comes up again,
every now and then we do hear from potential
companies that are interested in the service. Again, with the economy being so good, when you're looking at these type of services, it's hard to find folks. So the stability we have right now with our crew that has stayed with, you know, been with us the entire contract is obviously important. And also, if you do go out to bid and switch, you see a lot of turnover, and that becomes an issue for our school as well.
Also, now, so we did negotiate a great increase with the below CPI for this incremental borrowing, so it's not like this. On that, they did it on the side of now, so there's some negotiation we have.
I ask for a motion and a second to approve the GCA Services Group Distributor Recruiting Cleaning Services Contract for the Northwest Presenter.
Moved.
Moved by Mrs. Crabtree.
Second.
Second by Mrs. Erickson. Mrs. Hutchinson, would you please call the roll?
Mrs. Crabtree?
Yes.
Mrs. Erickson?
Yes.
Mr. Gambiani?
Yes.
Mr. Hamlin?
Yes.
Mr. Anderson?
Yes.
Mr. Paulson?
Yes.
Yes, the motion to approve the GCA Services Group is for the Cleaning Services Contract for the Rural West Presenter of the Past. Now move to discussion item. Discussion item number one is discussion of the 2018-19 fee schedule. Dr. Schuler.
So this is a continuation of the discussion that the board had a couple of meetings ago when we brought to the board an analysis specifically of the athletic and activity fees at our middle and our high school. So just by way of a point of reminder, the overall fee, we have some general registration fees that apply to all students based on level within the school district. Especially at the high school level, we have some course-specific fees that apply to individual courses that students might be taking, and then of course we have fees that are associated with athletic and activity programs. And so we brought that analysis to the board. A question was asked about some of the activity-related fees and where else are there fees that are perhaps collected for activities. And so Mr. Farley has provided for you in your green folder two pages that include all of the, those that we collect, the activity and in many cases some of the fine arts related activity fees that are charged both for Wheaton North and for Wheaton Northville South. Certainly there may be questions about those documents, but I do want to just kind of set, I think, a stage around the overall discussion for these fees. Just from my perspective, I would urge the board to kind of think about two reasons or perhaps conditions around which you might consider an adjustment to the fee. Clearly, as you're doing your financial projections for the following year, if you're in a situation or a specific situation where you're doing some cost containment, I think it's fair to have a discussion around some of the revenues that are associated with our programs. So again, I'm actually thinking about a year moving forward. Again, we are not projecting significant surplus for next year. We've made some very difficult budget decisions, several of which were approved tonight around facility work, but we are projecting a budget to be balanced next year. So just from my seat, I'm not sure that this is the financial year to talk about fee increase based on that. Second reason, though, that you might consider it is based on more of like a policy or practice perspective. So if you go back to that last set of fees that we brought to you, we showed you absent from perhaps some of the revenue that may be associated with individual fundraising that groups or organizations are doing, just the straight cost to run programs versus what's offset in the user fee. You saw that at the high school level, we're collecting about 25% of the associated cost through user fees. At the middle school level, I think that's up closer to 30%. And I think this kind of this analysis that we did, or activity is a good activity to do every couple of years to continue to see where we're tracking in terms of both cost for the district, which incrementally do rise as a result of offering these opportunities versus the fee piece. And so so I do think there is going to be a practice-related consideration of saying, if the board's interest is to kind of maintain the current relationship between portion of the costs that are upset or that are offset through student fees to the cost to run the activities, that could be a guiding practice through which, as we move forward, as we do this analysis, you determine if it's time to perhaps consider raising those fees. And so, so again, this there's nothing that's up for approval this evening. This is not an action item. It's a discussion item to ask from you if there's any other information that you need. But I think most importantly, I'm curious your reaction to kind of those two thoughts, because I think that will go a long way in perhaps informing the recommendation that would come back to the board when we bring the fees back. And again, this is just from my seat. I'm only the individual that recommends. You are obviously going to be the body that's going to approve it. I don't believe that this is the year to increase the fees for athletics and activities, but again, I certainly look forward to any feedback as we look toward that recommendation moving forward.
I have a couple comments and questions. One of the things I asked about the last time this came up was there were some discrepancies between schools for sports, and I don't see that in this. So if I remember correctly, it was the basketball. I thought one school was significantly higher than the other school, so I would still like to know that. I like the idea of let's set a fixed amount. You're going to fund 25%, whatever it is, and then go from there. The question is that a cumulative number, or are we looking at that for sports? Some sports are significantly, or activities are significantly higher than others. And I also question, are these true costs? Because the fundraising piece, I think, has to somehow come into this picture. And the reason I say that is because I've had multiple community members in the last 2 weeks contact me, and I'm in communities, baseball and softball, as the example. Those cards they have to send, they're looking at $650 per child. In some cases, they have more than one child playing that sport. Why are those fees out there? That's not giving us the true cost of what it is to run that sport if we're having to fundraise that amount of money. Are we doing that because we're going above and beyond with tournaments or things like that? And I think I brought that up a couple of meetings ago. Is there a basic that we need to be involved with? I just want us to be truly aware of what those costs are. I am someone who has all along said we need to look at these fees, but I'm really struggling with raising fees if we're not looking at cutting any expenses within that program. I think there needs to be a balance of what we're asking parents to pay and what we're spending. I think we need to look at some of the spending within these programs. I would like to know who is kind of the watchdog over what it is. Is somebody aware of how much fundraising is being asked of parents? I think when we're getting into numbers of $650, that's a big number in addition to the $150 that they're paying here, and who knows, maybe they're paying another fee of some kind along the way. I know as a parent of golfers, we had to pay additional fees. So are we truly aware of what we're asking, and how is that figured into actually what is the cost of running this sport? Because I don't think those fundraising fees are involved in here of the actual true cost.
I have some clarification just about these tracks that we're looking at here. I only have a sports page at the moment, and is each sport a user fee? Is that what the district is paying to run that sport as opposed to? I'm looking at your athletics page, you've got us. High school sports, revenue, badminton, baseball, basketball, boys basketball, etc. And there's a user fee. Is that the amount of money that the district is paying to run badminton for these 87 participants? Because Chris is asking the question, what is the cost to run it? And I'm having trouble sorting this out. Is this what it costs? This is what we're paying because we're going to have it and says that's how much I need to have it. And how are we separating out the extra money that the kids are fundraising and transvesting?
Yeah, so what you're looking at is a user fee. That's the revenue that's being collected specifically for that sport. The total cost of operating the sport is not broken out by individual sport. We do have an analysis that looked at it sport by sport. This is the summary, but the column you're looking at on the revenue, that's the revenue associated with participants in that.
Okay, so very sports is actually a flat fee times the number of participants minus the number of kids who don't pay in on this time.
We received something a couple of meetings ago, and I think we need that in front of us to for the next meeting when we are making decisions on fees, because that broke it out by sport, by school, and in some cases we had discrepancy between both schools in terms of what it was the true cost of that sport. And I think one of the things too, when we talk about that percentage, are we saying, again, is it an accumulative percentage for high school or is it by sport? I know we talked about sliding scales before. There's all different kinds of ways to do this. But until we really look at the spending within the sport, I struggle with raising a fee to the parents. Especially if they're funding significantly more on top of that.
Well, no, I just off the top of my head questions. When we approved lacrosse, there was a condition that would be funded primarily by exclusively by the families, which I believe is a different precedent or model than the rest of the sports. So if we're going to talk about fees, I'd like some material to understand if we're going to shift to a new model. What would this model look like? That's how I think about it. And I'm not quite sure how to do that given this information. Maybe that's a separate conversation.
I don't know that it's a separate conversation, but I guess what I was trying to frame out for you and I want to ask is, what's your driving reason for wanting to make a change? Right? I think at the board level, why do we want to change a model just to change a model, right? Unless obviously there's a driving interest in what it is that we're trying to improve in either the equity of that. Because you've asked the question a couple of times now that you want to just respond to it. I don't know that you, so again, separate from just the issue of should fees increase, is the question of, you know, do you have a different kind of structure that charges a different fee by sport? One of the challenges with that is that you set the fee at the beginning of the year before you actually will know the number of participants that will be in that activity. And so on one level, you're looking now at an autopsy of the current year to establish the fee. But I think if you try to set that kind of sport by sport, there's a good chance that you may miss based on the fact that whatever you set the fee at, you don't really know the true cost per kid until you see the actual number of participants for that year. And so that's why I think you've got to do that, looking at the sport events, at least looking at all of the activities in their aggregate.
So I found the report from our last meeting. So what I questioned, one of my questions was girls basketball at Wheaton North, it averaged $1,050 per student, same number of students per high school, 39, but at Wheaton North South, it was 786. So I had asked that question last time, and I'd still like an answer to that. Why do we have a discrepancy for the same sport per school? And I think maybe we have this chart back again as we have our discussion on fees, or we take the time to all go back and relook at this chart to see what are the true costs. And then I really want us to think about how we gather that information, other than coming right out and asking maybe our athletic directors, what are we asking parents to fund above and beyond this? And so, because that shows us truly what the true sport is and what is that fund, what is the purpose of that fundraising? Is it tournaments? Is it uniforms? Is it something else that we should be, as a district, maybe paying for to be able to have the sport? I think it's a large burden that we're putting on parents, and I'd like to understand what that. for the details.
I would also echo the question that Chris raised about whether there's a watchdog or whether there's anybody taking information on cost containment on each sport. And are we looking at what each sport is spending and whether that's reasonable or not?
I have, just to answer your question, I'm not sure. I just have two perspectives on why. One is, I think about access. And not just sports, but across the other extracurriculars, there are many issues. And the free and reduced policies we have, does it apply consistently across all activities, sports, and other programs? So I don't know. So I think about access, accessibility for folks that can't afford. The second thing I think of is consistency in fees. To be struck, instead of using the term fair, I want to use the term consistent. Is it consistent between both schools? Is it consistent? So our middle school is consistent, our high school is consistent. So I think about consistency and access. That's what would motivate me to rethink the structure. And then the last piece, which is just my perception is a good number, and I just look at the salary costs to salary benefits to one, it's about 1.4 million roughly. Then we throw the other stuff on, it's another 400,000 or so. But that seems like a big number, but I don't have anything to put that against this bond, or is it a big number or not. But when you think about all of our spend challenges we have, then I start thinking about the cost to actually run the program, the cost to have the appropriate coaches, and oversight, and some other services that are required to run the activity. So those are the three things I think.
Anyone else have any comments?
So why are we talking about athletic fees? So if you go back 11 months ago, 10 months ago, we came out of our referendum and there was this kind of hairs on fire, what are we going to do for some of us here? What are we going to do with finding money in the budget to pay for facility improvements, the expectations that the community was looking back at us, so we made some compromises last year, things that we're putting in the budget we chose not to. We kind of gravitated towards fees because that was an easy thing to look at. Did a little incremental increase to do that. This is like one little component that makes very little dent in really how we carve money out of our budget to address that, what we did last year. So I kind of had this feeling that there's all these other things that we could be looking at and maybe get a bigger dent, and it was part of hopefully the budget discussion coming forward. I don't want to make a rash decision to charge more money to students in New Jersey. These are already pretty significant costs that our students are paying without the context of all the other decisions we can make as well. I don't want to charge more to students to pay basketball or go on the shuttle. There's some pretty big costs here, and I think it's on us before we do another little incremental raise, which is going to have very little impact on the total net cost, so to speak, without having to raise this type of issue. So I keep looking forward to having those conversations, and I know we're getting to a time in the schedule here where those conversations can't be had this year. That's frustrating that we're in this budget process and people should come and can make some of those decisions that we don't want to make, but also isn't about the reason discussions.
Mr. Thompson, can you bring some clarity to what discussion we want to have? So I can appreciate that, I appreciate the feedback, and I want to be responsive to what the board is asking. Can you bring clarity to what budget discussions you are looking to have for next year?
Where else can we find efficiency in our budget to free up dollars that can be allocated towards facility improvements? Whether that's in the classroom, whether that's other programs and services we offer, whether it's a teacher issue, whether it's raising fees, whether it's deferring technology costs, again, I don't have a specific program or idea of where that is. I just know it's a really big, complicated discussion.
speak to the budget conversation and say, here's the budget.
So we've had this discussion a couple of times, and I guess, I will do what the board is asking me to do in terms of bringing information that for us to have the capacity to go through kind of item by item, program by program in the budget to really talk about every potential expenditure that you could keep or pull back. I'm struggling with seeing the path to the format of that kind of discussion. I get the desire to have it. I'm just struggling to see the path. And so I guess I would kind of continue to flip that to say, if the ultimate goal is having that discussion so more money can be freed up to put into the facilities bucket, it would probably be easier to have that charge around the target than it would be to try because I'm trying to comprehend how that would work going like, potential bucket by bucket that you can influence. So you can influence any bucket in the budget you want. And this is an organization, everywhere we put money is a choice for the number of FTE that we have, the programs that those support, any of the supply budgets, any of, kind of those pieces, those are all choices around which we could make some reductions, but of course those have impact, right, when we look at that. So, maybe based on this feedback, maybe it's a task that, Mr. Gorman, you want to charge the executive committee to spend some time sort of figuring out format. I don't want to go down sort of this directionless road and starting to say, well, what do we think about this expenditure in isolation? Do we think about this expenditure in isolation? Because I think it's going to be really difficult to evaluate that.
I want to kind of piggyback on this because I've had kind of those same thoughts that Brad has had too. I think kind of the direction we're going is we have X amount of level one capital neutral, calling it level one capital needs that are coming due in the next couple of years that are so significant we can't necessarily fix them all within that budget. We know for the year 2019-2020, if we're funding Sherman Durgis at what we said policy-wise, we're sitting about $3 million, am I right in saying that? $3 million in the hole. I would like to start having conversations sooner than later as to how are we going to address that $3 million, and are there, as Brad said, maybe efficiencies within there that we can start looking at that maybe aren't going to be super impactful on students, but I'd rather have those just start having, whether it's we're charging the finance committee or whoever, to have those, start having those discussions now versus waiting until next January and we're looking at now we need to cut $3 million off the budget just to make us, break even that year. So I would like to start having some discussions soon. But I understand why looking at a big picture versus isolation. It's very easy for us to go through and nitpick here and there because I mean, I understand one area and I favor another area, and I think we need to have that input from, I don't know that it's necessarily the board's place to say, oh, I want to cut X program. I think it's, we have $3 million to look at that we need to figure out, and where is that $3 million going from?
Correct me if I'm wrong. As we the advisory council kind of looked at this issue from the fall months and they developed the kind of recommendation of an outline of the task force, if you'd like to present to us on that?
Yeah, not specifically around cost containment.
No.
Around the whole picture, yes. But yes, not around cost containment. I guess, because that's exactly what I'm asking. So the charge of the board is we've been working on a cost containment plan to address that gap. We'll be working on that cost containment plan.
We know what the Sherman Jersey's application we have for the 2000 2023 will be. This summer, we've got enough projects going on to, when we tie up, we'll try the learning center and security work, security entry work, and other projects we've approved tonight. This summer's pretty much taken care of. My understanding is that we need to come to a fundamental understanding of how we want to meet our obligations in the coming years. It could be a combination of belt tightening in some sort and or other opportunities to explore financing alternatives. And I guess I'm searching for a way where we can have a kind of comprehensive discussion with regards to all those things, because we might not need as much belt tightening necessary. If you have some free employees where we can find some alternative financing methods to make sure we do this.
I think that what I'm hearing right now is that I think we need to say that this is one component of the big picture that we need to address. And this bigger picture is what we confront on our five-year projections and deficits, whether it's got sermon dirges funding, salary increase, whatever. And so this is one topic I think we can all grasp a little bit, and therefore we're spending a lot of time talking about it. I think it's important we have consistency and so on between schools. And you know, but then I think, you know, I was at the show choir event this weekend, and some of those schools were traveling from Oklahoma here. And I guess if the parents and the students that are in those programs want to support a higher fee, you know, that's part of the design of that program, and they're going to pay that amount. You know, we as a district are not, you know, are not going to pay for our students to go to Oklahoma, for instance. You know, I don't think that's within our control. So I think that those fees may vary because of the direction that the parents want to take in some of those programs. But I think the point here is that, you know, the big point is that we need to be looking at the big picture of where we can save. And I guess it starts off with every little bit helps. And so I think and that's where I've got frustration in the finance community dealing with this, because we are looking at a little component. And it's hard for me to say that's going to produce, you know, a small amount of revenue. But in the big picture, we've got to find $4 million, $6 million, whatever that number is. And this is one of those pieces. So I think the direction I would say as a board member, or the board should say, is that, you know, this piece you need to look at, this recommendation as you evaluate the whole big picture. I like the consistency. I recall at our chat with the board that was here, some of the students said they joined some of the clubs, you know, so it looked good on the resume and then they could stay. I want to make sure these clubs are, have enough interest to justify the cost, and that there is a fee sufficient to make it worthy of doing. You know, if there's two people on it, or, you know, as we go along, there's only two people on it, I don't want to be spending $1,000 of, you know, a guidance person for that. So I think, again, so in the big picture, looking at this by itself just doesn't, you know, it's only, it doesn't, we can't get out of it that way. So consistency. The other thing I heard from Chris was this thing about the very, you know, the fundraising outside. And that troubles me a little. How do we control that? What's it for? Do we know that? You know, again, it's PTAs raise money. They do things. It's controlled. It's, you know, there's give back on that. I don't know how we get back some of those dollars, for instance. I don't know that I need an answer right now. But if there's a program that requires $600 of tickets being sold, where's that money go? Does it come to the district? I haven't seen it in our gift. Okay, so, you know, what is it paying for? You know, maybe it's paying for our incentive. Well, you know, that's a problem. So I think that's a bigger picture, this question as well. So I think, again, you know, I don't think that I can focus on this other than consistency, but then on the other hand, I think, you know, this is what people are willing to pay. But I think I would like to know what's happening with these other fundraising components. So, it's tough to deal with this.
I want to make sure I answer your question you asked earlier, which is what do we need to do? What do we need to do? Because we're going to be asked to post this the next week, and then we'll try to improve it. So, consistency, that's kind of a broad statement. So, for me, I look at
just extending this sheet, which is user feedback by participants, and see, just extend it, and see what the unit, essentially the unit cost is, right? And we have it, we can look at it by school if possible, and I don't know if we can. So that would give me some visibility and consistency. Second, I mentioned access and consistent application of free and reduced policy across all activities, not just sports, but all of extracurriculars. And just a kind of confirmation that, yes, indeed, we are exercising that or following that guidance. The third thing I mentioned was salary, the cost for coaches. And I don't know if we can get this, but a number of FTEs by sport, and I don't know if we can get that, or by activity, sorry, not by sport, by activity. If we can get it, that would help me understand, you know, do we have, what are the headcount needs for this particular sport versus this particular extracurricular arts program, right? So there's an FTE kind of point of view too. And again, I don't know if we can get it, but that would help me. And then the last, which you mentioned, I didn't mention before, is fundraising. And I think everyone knows I'm a North Bay in there, and you know, I help with fundraising there. I do believe that there is governance around fundraising, that we have to, there a teacher needs to submit to the administration, or activities group or the administration, I'll need to correct my assumption, but if all the fundraisers that's going to be done, so we don't see overlap, we don't see groups kind of over fundraising, we don't see you know, people dipping into the same pool every time. So I do believe there's some governance there, but some visibility into what the governance is would be helpful. So those are the four things I think about that would help me, you know, with the conversation, just around the fee schedule. Because I don't think we're going to make decisions about cutting programs or changing things, but seeing those the data that way would help with at least for this year getting through that approval. I'll leave that.
Anything else?
One last thing.
I am aware that sometimes our requests can create a ton of work, and I don't have perspective on what I'm asking for is creating a ton of work, so if it is, I'd love to know more about that so we can adjust expectations as well. Because in my professional role, I get people rolling their eyes at me a lot, so I want to make sure that's not happening here.
The election commission, I think as mentioned earlier, will share or take a position that that ultimately the school district does have the ability to control our calendar. So while they can't control ultimately the decision to use the school, they do acknowledge the fact that we have control of our calendar to decide, in fact, if students will be in session on those days. I will say that as recently as last summer, the election commission did come back and revisit the thought of a conversation around perhaps expanding back into a couple of schools, and that did not happen. We worked with them, and certainly they found alternatives, and I do want to say moving forward, they have expressed a desire to work with us to find an alternative to one site that still is in use. So where are we right now with the election that's coming up next week? Again, we did work certainly with the building commission and with our local law enforcement to strategically determine what part of the building polling would take place inside of. And we've tried to provide the location that has the most separation from the building itself. Direct access into the polling will happen through an entrance right into the gym area that's being used, not through the main entrance to the school. The DuPage Sheriff's Department will have an officer present from 7 a.m. to 6 p.m. On that day. We will provide some adult supervision at that transition point from the polling place into the lobby as well. Mrs. Frederick is going to equip that supervision with radio so that we make sure we do in fact have access to administration and to the first responders should in fact we need it. Moving forward, our intent is to continue to work with the Election Commission to find an alternative to that Pleasant Hill polling place. As I mentioned, that's been an ongoing conversation, but we're still working on that. Certainly, the decision around kind of what we do in a future calendar is a future conversation that the board could certainly have. But I think coming back to that issue of the polling place, a couple of board members have kind of asked the question to say, what can the board do? I think with consensus, if the board would like for us to draft a letter to the Election Commission, just letting them know where you stand collectively as a board around your interest, happy to do that on your behalf. And certainly, Mr. Roman can help to deliver that letter if need be. But again, our immediate focus is on working with them to get that polling place relocated. Decisions around what we do with the calendar, there obviously are a lot of other kind of decision points that go into the placement of professional development days, how that calendar plays out, and so obviously the prime solution that avoids us having to compromise some of the other elements within the calendar is to relocate the place, and so that's kind of job one from our perspective. But I'll entertain any other questions or comments that board members have.
Yeah.
Just one question on that. If we look at a solution where we wanted to change the calendar, is it feasible to do it just for Pleasant Hill for that one day and not have to impact the rest of the school, elementary schools? Is there a way to work towards a solution like that that doesn't, it's just that one school?
So, couple thoughts on that, Brad. The provision in the school code around the number of days you're required to calendar applies to all our schools, right? So every school's got to have 180 days kind of built into the calendar. So to your question, could you run a different schedule? Could you do an institute day just at one building and then have a totally different day for the balance of the district? I think that have some implications that would be problematic. Through that before responding to it. Certainly in emergency situations, when the Bower had a flood a number of years back, you have an emergency situation, you can cancel within one school. Right? But that gets coordinated with the regional office to look at rationale for that emergency. I don't know that this would qualify in that meeting. I don't know, you could just say, Pleasant Hill students, you get one day less in school than everybody else.
You get everybody less one day more. Pleasant Hill could be minimum 180.
I've got a couple of comments and questions. This was a passion of mine. Back in 2011, I addressed the district as a Pleasant Hill parent. So it's been an issue with me myself. There are two things that I would like our board to see if we can get behind. One of them is have representation from the board actually meeting with the Election Commission. I think it's helpful for us to understand the process that we go through. I think we need a venue to voice our concerns, helps us problem solve. I think if we work with them together to reach out to local businesses, I know we've had parents reach
reach out to Pine Creek Golf Course, and they're seeming like they're interested in possibly taking that back. I think if we work together as a team with the election commission, other businesses may be more receptive. I live in that area. I can tell you, I've lived 20 years in my house in Woodfield. The Woodfield Park District is a polling place. Right down the street, not even half a mile, at the Baptist Church where I vote at is a polling place. Pleasantville Community Church is a polling place, and Pleasantville School is a polling place. I'm finding it very hard to believe in the 20 years that I've lived here, now that we have early voting, we need that many polling places. I think we need to have also that conversation with the election commission. I'd like us to, if they're not looking to change that Illinois law, I worry that it's out there as a law. We can make a change for a year, but are they going to stick with it? So if it's going to happen, maybe that spring voting day, we work with the ROE. It's not just our one school. There are still 37 schools in DuPage County that are in this situation. And I think we need to band together as a group of school boards. But the biggest thing that I think I would like to see us as a board do, I know this is kind of an out there idea, but that's kind of how I think. I would like us to talk to our federal congressional leaders and find someone to sponsor a bill that says voting now happens on a weekend. So many other countries have it. I know it sounds like it's an out there idea, but let's get someone behind this. I mean, that. Schools all across this country are facing this situation. If other countries can do it on a Saturday, why can't we? We could vote, all those schools would free up. And I don't think it's that ridiculous. Let's contact one of our congressional leaders, see if they'll sponsor that, and see if we can get any leads. I think it's worth a shot for our kids' sake that we are doing this and we're trying to be proactive for the future. Because like I said, we can fix something for a year, but 5 years from now, somebody new is in that position, are they going to bring it all back into our schools again? So it's something worth, I think, at least looking at.
I'm just asking the board, is there anything collectively you'd like to leave or reach out to the committee or the board commission to respect this, other than the various issues we've raised? So,
I have a question, Jim, before we get to that point. What you mentioned, there are seven other schools. What are the other districts doing on this? And I need to reinvent wheels all the time. I think the thought of having only one school is a problem because if somebody has a child at Pleasant Hill and then somebody at another middle school or high school, and they're not off the same day, that creates different kinds of problems. And the election commission in DuPage County may not exist over the next few years. It's a big movement that will make that. So I guess what are other districts doing in this regard? I keep getting back to the only way I think we can solve this is changing our institute days or whatever, district-wide. Some of them are pretty close. I know we try to match them up on weekends and so on, Mondays or Fridays as well, but I don't know. I think we have to find some kind of solution. I'm concerned about it more. We're just in the zero right now. This is a big issue. So, things that were in the past, that were such in the past, I don't know that I was attuning me personally as much as I am now. So I think that, I would like to find a solution. I don't know that we can do, obviously next week we're not going to find a solution better than what we have. But as we move into that next calendar year, is there something we can do? Or, again, what are other districts doing? I'd like to have some input from you.
Is our ROE taking a position on this? Are they responding to 37 schools in the same school districts? Do they have polling places in the school?
Yeah, I've not had a specific conversation with the ROE. So I'd have to reach out to the ROE to ask them. They have not conveyed a particular position on this.
Just so the public knows, one is, I appreciate the response, the voice of the public coming to the board, and then the staff drafting solutions and collaborating heavily and keeping the board engaged. We received multiple emails throughout the week, keeping us apprised of the situation, and multiple phone calls. And I thought the board was heavily engaged, and the public was heavily engaged, and I thought the staff and leadership team were
heavily engaged with other community, with other governmental entities to resolve the issue. So I thought that was just outstanding. I want to shine a light on that a little bit, because I think it's important for people to know the amount of collaboration and communication that took place. I like the idea of, Mr. Reynolds, I like the idea of having a board letter put together, just voicing a collective point of view. That might be like herding cats, but I think we put something together and send it. But that would be, I think that's appropriate. And then continue they're asking the questions they need to ask, not only of the school district, but of the election commission, the other government entities that are involved in holding our elections. So I appreciate the follow-up. I think the letters are very much appropriate.
So what I'm hearing is, we've done great stuff. It's probably as good as we can do for next Tuesday, right? I think we're taking our assessments, or taking collectively the board, lots of change, come up with a different solution. Can we agree with the idea of sending a letter and trying to be a little bit more vocal about it? Next step would be November. I like the idea of good bringing other schools or school districts that have the same issue as boys soccer and continue to support our projects. So, I think that's what I'm hearing we're all saying.
Thank you, Vernon. Monthly reports, we've all received monthly financial reports. And then I correct now that we received more timely payments from the state, but we've also seen more of the general fund as a result of the revenue from the financial reports. We're not only receiving more timely payments from the state, but we're also receiving more of our general fund as a result of the unemployment.
And we've seen the increase in that. We're getting a little bit more on a monthly basis of dollars in the world, which we were previously capped and now we're into the monthly piece. So, yes.
But we haven't seen that.
We haven't seen that. Yes, we haven't seen that. We checked it. This is supposed to come April, thought.
And then we've all received the capital employee report. Reports from board members, we have the committee reports from the finance committee, facilities committee, and the HR policy committee, both open and closed. Are there any other reports from board members?
I'd like to see a practice start that when we attend professional development opportunities that we share back, and several of us had the opportunity last week to attend the division IASB dinner and presentation, which was on the topic of unlearning. I thought it was one of the best that we have attended so far. It's asking school districts to stop doing things just because you've always done them that way. And they shared a few things, you know, the calendar being one thing, you know, how we have our calendar year set up, that was set up for more farming communities years ago. One of them that's sticking in my mind is that they talk about biology, chemistry, physics, that why we have that continuum for science, it was because that's how they are alphabetically. That was chosen biology, chemistry, and physics, and that's why we do it. Is that maybe the best way to do it? So it asks us to start thinking about things that we always do just because we do them, and start looking at other areas. And I thought that was a good thing that I think we kind of keep in mind. Last year, we attended the readiness one, you know, redefining ready. We took steps from that to kind of change how we're looking at that. I think we can take unlearning as well. What are the things that we're doing? Kind of maybe we make that a theme for the next year. What are the things that we're doing just because we've always done them that way? And start having some conversations around what's maybe the better practice than doing that. There's a book out there, I think we have a book, because it was a very interesting idea, got me thinking. But I do think we should talk about, if we are going to professional development opportunities, that we use that opportunity to talk about what we learned in the better
ways. I would invite any board member who would like to, or just one page report about the presentation we did together, since I was in the kind of group. I know all of the business that we can, somebody can take it up there and agree.
Not that I want to burden superintendent or anyone more than he's already burdened, but, you know, I'd like to know, you know, in this case, again, an example would be, you know, what is anything that we're hearing applicable, you know, to our district, you know, and how so or why not? You know, that's kind of the byproduct of those. I think, again, you know, I heard a lot of stuff and I'm learning, you know, I understand the concept, but what steps, if any, would be applicable to our district? That, I think that's, you know, the next step in that question. So just by reporting on it, to me, is nice, but, you know, I think we have to go to the next level, you know, say, is it applicable or not? And, you know, somehow incorporate that into that process.
The topics for future discussion include the Village Development Center Design Development Update. Following announcements, April 17, 2018, chat with the board from 8 a.m. to 9:30 a.m. at Wheaton North High School. On April 25, 2018, we have a meeting at the meeting at 7 p.m. at the School Service Center. Our next regular board meeting is April 11, 2018, at 7 o'clock at Edison Middle School. And do we have no public comments? I ask for a motion and a second for us to adjourn to closed session for the purpose of discussing employment compensation, discipline, performance, or dismissal of specific employees of the public body, the legal counsel for the public body, including hearing testimony on a complaint lodged against an employee of the public body, or against legal counsel for the public body, determining its validity pursuant to 5 ILCS 120/2, so paragraph C, so paragraph 1, and security procedures, building safety and security, and the use of personnel and equipment to respond to natural threat or unusual potential danger to the safety of employees, students, staff, public, or public property pursuant to 5 ILCS 120/2, so paragraph C, so paragraph 8. No action is expected to follow in the closed session. I have such a motion and a second. Moved by Mr. Carlson and seconded by Mrs. Erickson. Such a scene, please call the roll.
Yes.
Mrs. Erickson?
Yes.
Mrs. Crabtree?
Yes.
Mr. Damiani?
Yes.
Mr. Hamlin?
Yes.
Mr. Matheson?
Yes.
Yes.
Motion to adjourn the closed session is passed.
One time.
So this is the reason why I'm here.